Hello, friends of human spaceflight, and welcome to another week in review as we look into the space industry and notable launch activities from around the world. Coming up, join us as we take a look at some stunning imagery taken from MTGI-1. What is Rogozin smoking lately? Apparently, the US can't have landed on the moon, according to him. With JWST building on Hubble's legacy and beaming some fantastic pictures of the cosmos down to us here on Earth, where do we go from here? What's the next big telescope? Let's take a look through some promising proposals. And don't go anywhere, as we have a special guest joining us at the end for a surprise announcement. With all that to get through, I say it's time to get cracking, don't you? Time to disappoint all the flat earthers out there with the latest release of stunning imagery from Europe's latest and greatest weather satellite, the Meteosat Third Generation Imager 1, or MTGI-1. Taken on March, our blue marble is seen in all its glory, and what a magnificent image it is, showing a large area of northern and western Europe, Scandinavia, Italy, and the Western Balkans. Amazing cloud vortices observed as they swirl above the Canary Islands, as well as snow-covered Alps and even sediment along Italy's coastline. I've included a link in the description below to a nifty website as it features side-by-side comparison images from the new and previous generation satellites. Highlighted here is just one of the dramatic differences in image capture quality and detail. For example, the sediment along Italy's coast mentioned previously. MTGI-1 was launched December 12, 2022 aboard an Ariane 5 rocket and is the first of six such satellites. The system will produce imagery of the full disk, yes, disk, people, of Earth every 10 minutes once it's fully operational. For now, it will undergo instrument calibrations this year before coming online, providing meteorological services not only to Europe but to the rest of the globe. Yes. Globe. There are certainties in life, like death, taxes, sunrises, sunsets. Then there are some things you wish could just go away, like the coronavirus and Dmitry Rogozin. I mean, seriously, as if getting fired from Roscosmos, shipped off to the front line with Ukraine, and having your manhood shot off isn't enough? This guy was also shooting his mouth off again recently on social media. His anti-American dribble continues, and this time, it's about the moon landings. Well, according to him, it didn't happen, because America can't land on the moon now with the modern technology they possess. So they couldn't have done it in the past with old technology of the 60s and 70s era. Also adding that in his time at Roscosmos, no one in leadership provided satisfactory evidence to him that US astronauts landed on the moon. Rather, he was met with angry responses from his colleagues. He later called them NASA fanboys. His takeaway from all this was that Roscosmos had instead been infiltrated by the United States. It's hard to fathom the thought process behind such statements as this, and we really shouldn't waste too many neurons on it. There are other certainties in life that defy our logic and understanding, like black holes and what we think might be Dmitry Rogozin's brain. With a vast array of new data and pictures coming in from James Webb almost weekly, it made the team here wonder what the future of space-based telescopes may look like. Designed to answer the biggest mysteries of our universe, the Nancy Grace telescope will focus on dark energy, exoplanets, and infrared astrophysics, with an initial lifespan of 5 years and a potential to extend this by another 5. If the Nancy Grace Roman telescope lasts its initial 5 years, the $225 million budget would be split into $45 million per year. So let's hope that they can stretch it to its 10-year goal. Originally proposed as the International X-ray Observatory, or the IXO for short, by 2009 the project was cancelled, but ESA rebooted the project in 2011 with a new name, ATHENA, an acronym for Advanced Telescope for High Energy Astrophysics. With a planned launch in 2035, ATHENA aims to answer some of the biggest questions humans have regarding the formation and evolution of galaxies, as well as look at how black holes grow and shape their environment. Our mid-range price telescope has an estimated cost of 1.9 billion euros. Although its budget is a bit of a hot potato, as it was originally projected to cost 1.17 billion euros, and some speculate costs may go as high as 2.5 billion euros. The Large UV Optical IR Surveyor, or LUVOIR for short, is a concept for a highly capable multi-wavelength space observatory. This behemoth is proposed to start construction sometime this decade. At a proposed cost of $18 billion to $24 billion, it's not cheap. Factoring the cost plus nature of space sector at present, this could end up costing significantly more. LUVOIR have two proposed designs. LUVOIR A would have a 15-meter diameter, with LUVOIR B having an 8-meter diameter. For reference, the JWST has a 6.5-meter diameter. This monster would be placed at the L2 Lagrange point and would need a heavy lift launcher, such as the Block 2 Space Launch System, or the SpaceX Starship. Its job is to search for signs of life outside our solar system. These are just three of the many proposed space telescopes. Can you think of any others? Let us know in the comments below. For those of you still watching this episode, oh boy, do we have a treat for you. At the beginning of the month, NASA announced that JWST had found water vapor, but they weren't sure whether it was coming from a rocky planet or whether it was coming from the star. Well, today we have with us Dr. Ryan McDonald, who was one of the co-authors on this study, as well as a content creator on YouTube with his channel, Martian Colonists, to talk about this today. Over to you, Ryan.
Hello, I'm Ryan McDonald, an astronomer and NASA Sagan Fellow at the University of Michigan. I'm part of a team that is doing a survey of rocky exoplanets with NASA's JWST, searching for atmospheres on planets orbiting red dwarf stars. And we might have just found the first evidence of water vapor on a rocky exoplanet. In December last year, we observed GJ486b, a rocky exoplanet with a temperature around 700 Kelvin, about as hot as the surface of Venus. Our infrared spectrum shows a clear signature of water vapor coming from the planetary system, which could mean that GJ486b has a water-rich steam atmosphere. But after additional modeling, we found that star spots on the host star, which are cold enough to actually contain water molecules, could also explain these observations. We are hoping to reobserve this planet with a different instrument on JWST, using shorter wavelengths to distinguish the two possible explanations. Because if GJ486b does have a water-rich atmosphere, that would tell us that planets in the habitable zone of red dwarf stars can indeed have thick atmospheres and potentially be hospitable environments for life.
Well, that's it for now. While not much in the way of launches to cover, there is always plenty of other amazing news to share with you. We look forward to bringing you the latest developments in space news next week and some fun along the way. Thanks for watching, and remember, onwards to the future. Join us as we take a look at some stunning... I'm indicating over here, there's going to be nothing there yet. You're just introing everything.
Ooh, I live. Certain certainties in life.
Like life! And death. Taxes. Damn. Well, that's it.
No.
Such a bad clap. Well, that's it for now. We look forward to bringing you the latest...
No. Why am I fumbling that?
I do this every week! It's the outro!